الله سبحانه وتعالى says in Surah Ali Imran about the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم سبينا رحمة من الله لنت له. It's by the mercy of your Lord that you were made soft for them. ولو كنت فظا غليظ القلب لانفضوا من حولك. And had you been harsh in nature and hard-hearted, people would have dispersed from around you. فَعَفُ عَنْهُمْ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ وَشَاوِرْهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ. So Allah says to him, so excuse them, forgive them, and ask forgiveness for them, and seek their counsel. فَإِذَا عَزَمْتَ فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُتَوَكِّلِينَ. And if you decide to do something, then trust in Allah, and Allah loves those who trust in Him. These ayahs, this ayah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, is telling us that the Prophet ﷺ, when Allah says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, we only sent you as a rahmah to all of the people that are responsible, people of takleef. We only sent you as a rahmah to these people. And also, one of the meanings of the ayah, we only sent you a rahmah to all the world. So the da'atha to the Prophet the Prophet ﷺ, his being sent is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His da'atha of takleef is to the people of intellect. But his da'atha of tashreef is to everything else. In other words, everything in the universe is honored by the Prophet ﷺ's being sent. And if we look at the character of the Prophet ﷺ, Allah is describing here that he was a rahmah, and he had gentle character and nature. Sayyidina Ali, in his description of him, he said, كَانَ أَلْيَنَ النَّاسَ عَرِيكَةً. He was the gentlest of people by disposition. عَرِيكَةُهُ, his disposition, his خُلُق, was layyin. It was soft. And he said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, مِنْ جُوَانِ أَكَرِمِهِ, from those words that have great comprehensive meaning, he said, الْمُؤْمِنُ هَيِّنٌ لَيِّنٌ. The mu'min is gentle and easy by nature. And when he was described by one of his sahaba, he said, مَا كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمُ مُعَنِّتَ وَلَا مُتَعَنِّتَ وَلَكِنْ كَانَ مُعَلِّمًا مُيَسَّرًا. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, by his nature, wasn't, he didn't make things hard for people, nor did he seek out people's faults. But he taught people and he made things easy for people. He taught people and he made things easy for people. So part of his character, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was that he was sent for taysir to human beings, to take out the ahlal, the difficulties, the chain, the weight of previous dispensations, previous traditions. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to take the burden of all of that off of people and give them. He said, bu'ithu بِالْحَنَفِيَةَ السَّمْحَى, I was sent with the forgiving Hanafiya way, the gentle Hanafiya way. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, رَحِمُ اللَّهُ إِمْرَأً سَمْحَى, may Allah have mercy on a man who's forgiving. إِذَا بَعَ وَإِذَا اشْتَرَى, if he sells or if he buys, he has سَمَحَى. So if the Prophet said there's mercy on people when they buy and they sell, they say, خلاص, if the man has 10 dirhams and it costs 12 dirhams, خُذُوا عَلَى بَرَكَةِ اللَّهِ, take it, don't worry about the 2 dirhams. Or the man who only doesn't have change, the merchant doesn't have change, خلاص, take the dirhams. That's سماحة. It teaches people how to be forgiving. It's the same word they have used for tolerance. The same word they use for tolerance. I was sent with the tolerant way of the Hanif, the one who inclines towards the Haqq. Allah begins his book, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawmi Din, ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. He says it again. He says it again, twice. Which in Balagha is very unusual. Unless there is a strong emphasis there. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So, Maliki Yawmi Din, رب العالمين, is a strong attribute. Maliki Yawmi Din is a strong attribute. But between these, Allah is reminding Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. And the Prophet is Rahman. he's the greatest manifestation of Allah's rahmah to his creation is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Is the greatest manifestation of his rahmah to his entire creation is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And from the rahmah that this Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave us is his character. How he was. Not simply the ahkam, but how he lived the ahkam. When Aisha radiallahu anhu was asked how was his character, she said, كَانَ خُلُقُ الْقُرْآنِ رَضِيَ بِهِ وَأَرْضَاهِ. He was the Qur'an in nature. His nature was the Qur'an. His character was the Qur'an. And the Qur'an is called إِنْ هُوَ لَقُرْآنُ عَظِيمٌ. Right? It's a Qur'an عَظِيمٌ. إِنْ هُوَ لَقَسْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. كِتَابٌ مَكْنُونٌ. This is a vast oath. The oath of that Allah is swearing by the nature of the Qur'an. That this is a great Qur'an. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the Qur'an great. And he made the Prophet's khuluq great. Because the khuluq is following the Qur'an. And the Qur'an is azim. So anyone who yatakhalaqu bi akhlaq al-Qur'an, khuluquhu la mahala sayakun azima. Anyone whose khuluq is the Qur'an, is Qur'anic by nature, then he'll be azim. His khuluq will be azim. But the Prophet is the greatest embodiment of the Qur'anic character and nature. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in this ayah, we're being told that it's by Allah, or bi rahmatin min Allah. It's because of a rahmah from Allah that He made you that way. He made you a rahmah, and it's from His rahmah that He made you a rahmah. And if you were fard, fadada is harshness in the self. If you were fard, or ghaliz al qalb, ghilz is heaviness. If your heart was heavy, if it was weighty, then fadda nas min hawla. People would. By nature, people do not like people to be harsh with them. If you look, Aristotle, he said, the root cause of all enmity amongst human beings is that somebody feels slighted by another person. Ihana. The sense of ihana. They said in the Prophet ﷺ gathering, كَانَ يُعْطِي أَصْحَابَ كُلَّ ذِي حَقٍ حَقَّهُ. He gave everyone who had a due coming a haq. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his gathering, he would give everybody, they said he used to give everybody his attention so that each one thought he was the most important one in the gathering. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli alayhi. It's amazing. Each person, he gave them to make them feel he was the most important. He was the most beloved. He didn't make muhabbat. People didn't see muhabbat from the Prophet. In one narration, he had two sticks, a siwak, and a Arabi was there, and one of them was broken. It had an i'wijaj in it, and the other one was straight. And he looked at the two, and then he gave the Arabi the straight one, and he kept the crooked one for himself. Ithar. One of the shiukh said, if this is his ithar for a simple Bedouin who doesn't care if it's crooked or straight, what about the rest of the people closest to him? So his nature was like this. One of them, he says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was in the prayer, and somebody sneezed, and the ahkam were becoming down. They didn't know all the ahkam. This man, somebody sneezed, atasa, and he said, "Ya rahamukullah," and he said, everybody looked at him in the prayer, like, "Are you crazy?" He said, "Saru yanzuruna ilayya." And he said, "Uskara ummayah, you know, may your mothers weep over you. You know, why are you looking at me?" I just said, "Yarhamukallah." They all started striking their afkhad, yadribun bi afkhadihim bi aydihim, like this. And he said, "Yusammitun," and they were trying to make me shut up for sakattu. He realized he was doing something wrong. He was quiet. He said after the prayer, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, da'ani. He called me to come over. And he said, ma kaharani, wala darabani, wala shatamani. He didn't look at me in a harsh way. He didn't say anything mean to me. He didn't strike me or hit me. He said, inna hadhihi as-salah. This is a prayer. Wala yaslahu fiha shay'un min kalam an-nas. Innama hiya tasbihun. This is our prayer, And we don't talk in our prayer because it's not appropriate for the prayer. It's just saying, Allahu Akbar, saying Subhanallah, saying, he said, Wallahi, ma ra'aytu mu'alliman qablahu wala ba'dahu ahsana minhu. I never saw anyone teaching before or after him who was better than him. One man said, everything in Islam made sense to me except for one thing, I loved. He loved women. He wanted to go and sleep with whoever he wanted. He said, I came into the Prophet ﷺ and I told him, Ya Rasulullah, I want to become Muslim, but I love zina. And the Prophet ﷺ said to him, do you have a sister? He said, yes. He said, would you like somebody to go and sleep with your sister? He said, hasha. He said, you have an aunt? He said, yes. He said, would you like somebody to sleep with your aunt without haqq? He said, hasha. He said, you have a mother? He said, yes. He said, would you like somebody to do that to your mother? The man said, no. He said, wallahi, I went in and I loved sleeping with women more than anything, without the responsibility. He said, I went out of there and it was the most detestable thing to me. This is the way that the Prophet ﷺ, and this was his way in changing people, transforming people. When the man came to him and said, Ya Rasulullah, halaktu, halaktu. I'm destroyed, I'm destroyed. He said, what happened? He said, I slept with my wife in the daytime in Ramadan. The Prophet ﷺ said, free a slave. He said, I don't have any possession. He said, then feed 60 people. He said, fast 2 months. The man said, Ya Rasulullah, I can't, Ramadan I'm having trouble. He said, get some dates and feed people. So he said, I don't have any money, I have nothing to buy dates with. He told somebody, bring some dates. He gave him the dates, gift. تصدق به على الناس. Go give it to the people. He said, Ya Rasulullah, do they have to be fuqara? He said, they have to be fuqara. He said, Ya Rasulullah, no one's poorer than my own family. He said, go give sadaqah to your family. Feed your family. Taysir. This, he's just making things easy for people. This was his nature and his character. His character was such that when he walked amongst the people, he would stop and talk. He would ask people how their state was. Khawla bin Sa'adaba came to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and complained about her husband. The Prophet sabbaraha. Be patient. Sabbaraha. And then she went back and she went to Allah. She said, Ya Allah, I complained to the Messenger of Allah. He didn't help me with my husband. Because he had zihar. He made her, divorce her in a way. Allah sent down, فَسَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّتِي تُجَادِلُكَ. Allah has heard this woman who's complaining. She argued with you, saying that she didn't agree. And Allah hears the conversation. And then Allah prohibited for that, that she, when Umar saw this woman, years later, after the Prophet ﷺ had died, she came, she called him. And he was with a group of his bitana, the important people of the, and the affairs of the Muslims, you have to realize, Umar, the affairs, big dawla, he's dealing with Persia, Rome, they're all, because he's the head of a massive dawla. And the woman came, he sat, talked with her at the side of the road. His companion was saying, ya Umar, we have business to attend to. When he went, and this is the sunnah of the Prophet, when he went, came back, he said, do you know who that is? They said, no, who's that? Khawla. That's the woman Allah heard from seven heavens. He said, I don't want to her to complain about Umar. So this was the tarbiyah that he was doing, teaching people how to listen. They said if he spoke to anybody, he gave them his full face. He didn't look like this. If somebody called him, he turned completely around and gave him his entire being. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All of these things he did to teach his ummah. When Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu was going to Hajj, he said, اذكرني عند ربك يا أخي my little brother. Tasghir for istinas, right? It's to show his intimate nature of his love for Omar. He said, remember me in dua to your Lord. Omar said, wallahi, I never heard anything from the Messenger of Allah that was more precious to me in the heavens and the earth than those two words. Just say to me, اذكرني عند ربك. Remember me. And this is ta'aleem in the nas, tawadu'uhu, his humility amongst his sahaba. Some of the people used to come into the gathering, they didn't know who the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was. Because of one, the Nur al-Muhammadi has become so inundated in all their beings. You know, they were illuminated people. So that's one aspect of it. But another is that he did not raise himself up. He didn't raise himself up above his own companions. In fact, some of them came and asked him to make a chair so that people could see, so that they wouldn't get confused when they came in. The man who came in, the Bedouin came in, he started to shake. The Prophet said, Hawan Ali, go be gentle on yourself. He said, Ana ibn imra'atin kana ta'kul al-qadid. I'm a son of a woman who used to eat dried meat. I grew up here from you. الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا هو الذي اللهم صل على سيدنا آخر الكلام لقد جاءكم رسول من أنفسكم. He came from amongst yourselves. من أنفسكم, and in رواية من أنفسكم, the most precious of you. من أنفسكم he came. حريص عليكم, he is so concerned about each one of you. حريص عليكم بالمؤمنين رؤوف الرحيم. And he has رأسة and رحمة. Specific رحمة, رحيم. Specific رحمة for his ummah. On the يوم القيامة he has شفاعة. For who? The people of كبائر. The people who were drinking alcohol and fornicating and doing, that's who he's concerned about, that they don't go to the hellfire. صلى الله عليه وسلم. بالمؤمنين رؤوف الرحيم صلى الله عليه وسلم. One another is his with the children. If you look at the way he taught Anas ibn Malik رضي الله عنه, his mother came when he was a young boy in early, like 7-8 years old, came in and she said, I want him to serve you. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم took him, and it's important because Anas becomes one of the greatest teachers of Sahaba. Somebody grew up in the Bayt al-Nabuwa, spent 10 years. He said, I served the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam 10 years. He never once struck me. He never once said to me, if I did something wrong, why did you do that thing? And if I did something, if I didn't do a thing he asked me, why didn't you do it? Never once in 10 years. Anas said, once the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came in and he said, yeah, Anas, can you go and do such and such? And he said, no. He's a young boy. Boys do that, right? He's a young boy. They do that. The Prophet smiled, ibtisam, and then he left the room. This is very significant. This is some children. They expect you to get mad. They want to challenge you. He smiled. He smiled at them, and then he left the room. You see, you have to leave it. Right? He came back a little while later, and he said, Anas, did you do that thing I asked you? He said, I'm going right now. It's amazing, tarbiyah. When he came in amongst the, look at the children that grew up around him, Abdullah ibn Zubair. When Omar came down the road, all the children ran away, except for Abdullah ibn Zubair. And Omar said, why don't you run? He said, I didn't do anything wrong that I should be afraid of you, and the road's wide enough to suit both of us. These are awlad al-sahaba. Awlad al-sahaba. The Anas ibn Malik had a little boy, a little brother named Abu Umair. And Abu Umair, his father got him a little bird that he used to play with. They call it nughar, a little type of bird. And he said, كان يدخل علينا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يزورهم. He used to visit them sometime. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, once he came over and he saw Abu Umair was sad, كان حزينا. فسأله ما شأنه. What? he's coming to visit the family. He sees one of the family members is depressed. Right? Some people, they go in, they're not even aware of states of people. He came in, he looked, he saw he's depressed. Ma sha'nuhu. He's a little boy, he was younger than Anas. Little child. Ma sha'nuhu. They said, mata nugarahu. His little bird died. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went up to him and he said, Ya Abu Umair, ma fa'ala nughair? Abu Umair, what did the little nughair, what did it do? Subhanallah. Ma fa'ala nughair? It's a deep question. He's asking the boy, one, becoming aware of death. What did the little bird do? It died. This is the nature of the world. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani says about that hadith, over 100 mas'ala have been derived from that hadith. Over 100. From that one hadith, over 100 mas'ala have been derived. And Abd al-Hayr Kattani says in Tartib al-Idariya, 300. If you look at all the different people that have used that, the istishhad, that have used that hadith to prove different things, he said you'll come to 300. Ziyara, the permissibility of keeping a bird in the house in a cage, the permissibility of giving children pets, the importance of asking even about the children of the house and their fate, the importance of being concerned about the fate of the child. Many, many different masail come for that one hadith. So the Prophet ﷺ did all of these, all of his actions were teaching. All of them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Once he was walking with Hussein on his shoulders, and a man passed by and he said, Ni'm al-Markab to Hussein. What an excellent riding, Markab is what you ride on. What an excellent riding vehicle you have. And the Prophet ﷺ said, Ni'm al-Rakib. What an excellent rider. Right? You see, tashreef, like honoring the child, you know, giving him importance. And this is what the Prophet did. He made people feel important. He gave them importance. And this is nurturing the soul. Because Allah has created the human being, and the human being does have importance. It's not insignificant. أَيَحْسِبُ الْإِنسَانَ أَنْ يُتَرَكَ سُدَى Does the human being think he's just left in vain? That he doesn't have importance, his being doesn't have importance. No, this is about akhirah, jannah, not. This is about submission to Allah. And so the mu'mineen are important. The Prophet ﷺ said that one killing one mu'min is more atrocious with Allah than destroying the entire Kaaba brick by brick. Human beings are important, they're not insignificant. And this is what he let people know, his concern for people. He had a haiba that Allah gave him that he didn't use against people, because some people in positions of power and authority, they use it to exploit people. He did the opposite. Allah gave him that, and yet he made people feel at ease. This is why they said, إِذَا لَقِيَهُ بَغْتَةً أَحَابَهُ If they met him suddenly, they went into awe. وَإِذَا خَالَقُهُ أَحَبَّهُ But if they were sitting with him, spending time, they fell in love. When the people of Kisra, and not just the non-Muslims, the Muslims, Allah put this in the hearts of the non-Muslims, when the people of Kisra sent messengers, when they came into his presence, they felt more awe than they did in the palaces of Kisra. And he slept in Turab, he used to sleep on the floor. He would sit on the earth like this. When I was in Giru, there was a sheikh, he died, Minu, Rahimahullah. And I went and visited him. He was bent over. And he was very, very salih. Tawufiya. And he told me, Rahimahullah, he used to sit always on the earth, on the dust. Other people would put out a hasira, you know, like a grass mat for his guests. And he would sit on the dirt. And then one day I was sitting with him and he picked up some of the earth and he put it up and he said, Hamza, hadhihi ummukum fala tabta'id anha. This is your mother. This is what you came from. Don't distance yourself from it. You know, don't become mutakabbir. We're from earth. And this is something the Prophet ﷺ reminded people of. تواضع لله. من تواضع لله رفعه الله. The one who is humble for Allah's sake, Allah raises him up. And the one who raises himself up, Allah lowers him down. The Prophet ﷺ had a camel that used to beat all of the camels. And the Sahaba, they were very, very happy about this. Like it's almost like a proof. Even his camel beats the other camel. And one day an Arabi came. And the Arabi, they're the people of camels. He came and he raced the Prophet's camel and he beat him. And وَقَعْ فِي نُفُوسَ الصَّحَابَ. It's like they felt grievous that his camel lost. And the Prophet ﷺ said, nothing in this dunya gets raised up except Allah lowers it. Nothing in this dunya gets raised up, Allah lowers it. Because his camel was getting shuhra, everybody was knowing it. Look, get lowered, get abased, get humbled. This is the way he was teaching, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you look at his character, you have to fall in love with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you study the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you have to fall in love. Wallahi. You know, and Imam al-Qarafi radiallahu anhu said in al-Furuq, he said, if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had no other miracle than the men and women he produced, لَكَفَوْ مُعْجِزَةً لَهُ, they would be enough as his miracle. He took simple, primitive people and turned them into the greatest thinkers, the greatest people of adab, really, of erudition, of culture. And he took simple people, Bilal al-Habashi. Bilal becomes a giant amongst men. And he was an Abyssinian slave. Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, he was from a Bedouin tribe, Bani Ghifar, they were brigands. Brigands. They used to rob the highway. When they found out, they beat him mercilessly until he was unconscious at Kaaba, until Abu Bakr said, that's a Ghifari. Quraysh, suddenly they all stopped. You don't mess with Bani Ghifar. They were worried about Sa'ar. You know, vengeance. That's the tribe he was from. They were like ruthless people. And Abu Dharr becomes, subhanAllah, Abu Dharr. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. I mean, look at this man. A man who was a shepherd in the hills of Mecca. A shepherd. Go look at a shepherd now. Seriously, they're simple people. No ideas, nothing. Really, they're very simple people. If you go to a place where there's still shepherds, very simple people. They don't think about a whole lot. Ibn Mas'ud, a shepherd, becomes a teacher of generations. He teaches generations. You know, his teaching is still in the Hanafi Madhab. The Hanafi Madhab is Ibn Mas'ud, radiallahu anhu. I mean, that's 80% of the Muslims are coming out now of the madrasa of Ibn Mas'ud, who came from the madrasa of the Prophet ﷺ. Each one of them, you mention each one of them, Zubair ibn Awwam. The Prophet said, everyone has Hawariyun. All Prophets have some disciples. He said, Zubair is from my Hawariyun. Zubair ibn Awwam is an awesome personage in Islam. His son, Abdullah ibn Zubair, when he takes the Khilafah in Mecca, and they send Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, he goes to Asma. His mother is Asma. Zatu Nitaqain, the possessor of two belts for life for the Messenger of Allah. She's the wife of Zubair ibn Awwam, and the mother of Abdullah ibn Zubair. And he goes to her. She's blind at this age, in her 80s. And he tells her what's happening. And he said, look, if you did this thing for shuhra, if you took the khilafah to be called khalifa and etc., bi'sa ma san'at, what a wretched thing you've done. And he said, but if you took this khilafah for haq, then fight for the truth. And he said, I'm going to lose. He said, then you're shaheed. And then he said, but I'm worried that they will mutilate my body. And he said, what does the slaughtered sheep care what the butcher does after its death?
What does it care? And he went out and died at Kaaba, fighting against the oppressors. So these were the men and women that that the Prophet ﷺ were around him, which is the best testimony to his greatness, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the best thing that we can do, I mentioned earlier the you know, that one of the books that Murabtar had used for years, they said, and he memorized the book and practiced everything in it, is the book of Shama'il al-Tirmidhi. You know, the character of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Tirmidhi, Imam al-Tirmidhi, radiyallahu anhu. You know, we should immerse ourselves in that. And the other great book is the Shifa of Qadi Iyal, radiyallahu anhu. The great book, and it's in English as well. Just to look and learn about him, we just left Rabi'ah, now we're in the Rabi'ah al-Thani. There's new moon out there. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his dua was Allahumma hilla alayna bil amni wal iman wa salamati wal islam rabbi wa rabbuka Allah. We ask Allah to give us this month of yuman and iman, of good omens and of faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa salamati wal islam, and safety and Islam, submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us people of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, make us worthy of his companionship in the Akhirah. He said, أَقْرَبْكُمْ إِلَيَّ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَحَسِنُكُمْ أَخْلَاقًا. The closest of you to me on the Day of Judgment are the best in character. If you want to be good in character, all of us, and I talking to myself first and foremost, we have to look at his character and then do mujahada with our own self. He said, إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ بِالتَّعَلُّمْ. Knowledge is through acquisition. وَإِنَّمَا الْحِلْمُ بِالتَّحَلُّمْ. And forbearance and patience with people is through acquisition. We have to acquire it. We have to acquire it. And the way we acquire it is looking at how he behaves and acted in different situations and attempting the best of our ability to do that. And inshallah, one of the things Sidi Ahmed Zarruq says, that if you don't find a murabbi, then do lots of prayer on the Prophet ﷺ, because that takes the place of the murabbi. If you do much prayer on the Prophet ﷺ, that will, by its nature, do tahdeeb an-nafs. It will change yourself and illuminate the self and make the self in harmony with what the Prophet ﷺ came with. And he said, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يكون تكون هواه تبع لما جئت به. None of you truly believe until his inclinations are in accordance with what I have brought, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so, doing prayer on the Prophet. And the other thing that is amazing about prayer on the Prophet, by ijma' of this ummah, prayer on the Prophet is the only dua that there's absolute guarantee that it's answered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All the other are in the mashi'ah of Allah. If he wants, he'll answer it. If he does. But if you pray on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad, Allahumma salli alayhi wa sallam, if you do that, it's guaranteed that it will be answered. And this is why the ulama said, if you want your dua answered, then pray on the Prophet in the beginning of it and at the end of it, because Allah is more generous that he should refuse to accept what was between the two. So we ask Allah, inshallah, make the prayer on the Prophet on our tongues all the time, inshallah. And he told one of his sahaba, came to him, and he said, Ya Rasulullah, how much of my prayer should I make on you? And he said, is a fourth good? He said, a fourth good, and if you do more, it's good. He said, two-thirds good, one-third, two, and then he said, two-thirds, and he said, if you do that, it's good, if you increase, it's good. And he said, what about doing all of this on you? He said, if you do that, it's good. And because of that reason, some people have that, they've made that their zikr. They do prayer on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then the other thing he said, عَلِمُوا أَوْلَادِكُمْ حُبَّ نَبِيِّكُمْ وَحُبَّ تِلَاوَةِ كِتَابِكُمْ وَحُبَّ آلِ بَيْتِ رَسُولِكُمْ. Teach your children, أو كما قال, teach your children to love their Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Teach your children to love recitation of the Quran. Teach your children to love the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Him tabarani. So it's important to nurture in our children love of his family as well, and love of the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and love of the book that he brought to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the sabab, he's the wasila through which all of this khayr has come to us. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, man lam yashkur innas lam yashkur illah. Doesn't thank people who are the means of your good, hasn't thanked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's what Allah demands, that we thank the sabab as well. Even though Allah is the ultimate al-musabbab al-wahid. Everything is Allah. Allah creation through wizarding, through means, and so we have to thank the means. And the greatest of all of our means is the means which we have guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's through the Messenger of Allah. And then by then, through the shuyukh, who through the centuries have learned and struggled and spent their nights in mudarasa and muraja'a and mudakara to convey the deen to each generation. So we also thank them for doing that, for writing the books that they wrote. Really, for keeping this knowledge for us. So that to this day, we can even mention these things. We have the narration. We know the fact because of the greatness of the people before us. And so all of those shuyukh, we thank them all from the bottom of our hearts, all the way back to the Messenger of Allah and to the greatest of the giver of gifts. Alhamdulillah. Wa iyyakum inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.